In the category of musical pairings, few musicians shared a more powerful common bond than Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn. Billy Strayhorn lived with his grandmother in North Carolina for long stretches of his childhood. He credited her with his early exposure to music. His ambition was to be a classical composer, but that world was virtually closed to a black man. He turned to jazz as an alternative, which turned out to be fortuitous for the jazz world. He composed some of his most famous tunes when he was still a teenager, including Little Brown Book and Lush Life. The original title of Lush Life was Life is Lonely, and that could have been a reflection of his feelings as a gay black man at a time when both would have subjected him to prejudice and oppression. Strayhorn first met Ellington in 1938, backstage after a concert. He showed Duke how he would have arranged one of his tunes, which seems like a brazen move, but Duke was taken, and he introduced Strayhorn to members of the band. That meeting was the beginning of a lifelong partnership as co-composers and alter egos. Strayhorn brought a more studied classical approach to Duke's compositions, but the collaboration was so seamless that it could be hard to tell where one's writing ended and the other began. In Duke's words, "Billy Strayhorn was my right arm, my left arm, all the eyes in the back of my head. My brainwaves are in his head and his are in mine." Duke referred to Strayhorn as Stray or Sweet Pea. Now, I don't know how that one got applied, but Sweet Pea was the name of a cartoon baby who was left on Popeye's doorstep in 1933, and it was a term of endearment that Popeye used for his girlfriend, Olive Oil. Now you know. There is some controversy about whether Strayhorn resented the fact that Duke got the lion's share of accolades for their co-compositions. But their relationship endured, and on later major works, Strayhorn got full credit as co-composer. Strayhorn spoke out forcefully during the Civil Rights Movement, and he was a friend to Martin Luther King. In 1963, he and Duke collaborated on a set of music for a stage show called My People, which was a plea for racial parity and harmony. Strayhorn died in 1967 from esophageal cancer. He composed his last tune, Blood Count, while he was in the hospital, literally watching his blood count drop. Duke recorded the tune on his tribute album called And His Mother Called Him Bill, which won the 1969 Grammy for Best Large Instrumental Recording. This is a portion of a cut from the same album, which clearly was not planned. As the band packed up at the end of the recording session, you can hear them in the background, the engineers let the tape run while Duke sat at the piano and played Strayhorn's tune Lotus Blossom. The emotion is palpable. Duke seems not to want the song to end. Duke spoke and wrote these words about his friend. Billy Strayhorn demanded freedom of expression, freedom from hate, freedom from self-pity, and freedom from the kind of pride that might make a man think that he was better than his brother or his neighbor. In this clip from 1965, Duke brings Strayhorn out to the piano for an encore to play Take the A-Train, which was Strayhorn's tune but became Duke's theme song. Around the 1:30 mark, the cameraman zooms in on Paul Gonsalves, who'd fallen asleep on stage. During the applause, Duke is generous with his praise for Strayhorn, and the audience responds in kind.
Billy Strayhorn is our encore. Billy Strayhorn. Billy Strayhorn. Take the A train. Passion Flower. Chelsea Bridge. Billy Strayhorn, a deep rock.
After the 1956 Newport concert, the subsequent 2 decades for Duke were his most productive. Often collaborating with Billy Strayhorn, he wrote extended works including suites, film and theater scores, and Christian liturgies. He also collaborated in small group recordings with Louis Armstrong, Count Basie, John Coltrane, and others. When he was nominated for but failed to win the Pulitzer Prize at the age of 65, Duke replied with magnanimity, "Fate does not want me to be too famous, too young." In 1999, on the centennial of his birth, Duke was posthumously awarded a Pulitzer, and his likeness appeared on a U.S. quarter. Duke performed right to the end of his life, dying 2 months after his final performances in 1974. Of Duke Ellington, Gunther Schuller said, "His commitment to music was incomparable and unalterable. Duke Ellington may one day be recognized as one of the half-dozen greatest masters of our time." Here he is with Dizzy Gillespie in 1959. Duke and his counterpart, Count Basie, in 1961, two veteran bandleaders. This is Duke receiving the Presidential Medal of Freedom from President Richard Nixon in 1969. Duke kissed Nixon twice on each cheek, which was his habit. When Nixon asked him why twice, Duke replied, "One for each cheek." Eloquence was a hallmark of Duke Ellington. Quotes reveal the mind of a passionate and deep thinker, yet with a casual tinge of authenticity and humor. By and large, jazz has always been like the kind of man you wouldn't want your daughter to associate with. Sometimes critics get a little carried away with what they think someone should have done rather than concerning themselves with what he did. Everybody in Canada seems to listen to what they enjoy. It is very hard to brainwash a Canadian. Simplicity is a most complex form. You've got to find a way of saying it without saying it. The thing I look for in a musician is whether they know how to listen. Music is the tonal reflection of beauty. Finally, the title of what is probably Duke's most famous tune sums up the life's work of an extraordinary individual. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. The Jazz History series continues in the next episode. Before you go there, please take half a second to click the like button for this one.